you all for being here. I'm greatly looking forward to an hour in which I get to speak to a writer I've admired for very long. Thank you for being here, Jerry Pinto.
And allow me to also say
at this point that this is Supriya Nair, who has very kindly agreed to interview me. Many people were asked, but only one person agreed after much persuasion, I'm sure. Supriya is a very well-known journalist and many counts, but one of the most interesting things about her is her genuine and truly critical engagement with the world of words. I've read her on various other subjects as well, but what I truly relish about her writing is how she makes space for the work that she is addressing, not on her terms, but on the terms she tries to engage with the writing on the terms that is set by the writer. And this is a very rare thing, because most of the time I find that I'm being told what I should have written, which is really what that person who is reviewing me wants to have written. And it's often nice to just be addressed as for what one has done, you know, which is really nice. So thank you, Supriya.
Well, thank you, Jerry. And I think part of the reason almost all of your work interests me so much is, I don't know, maybe we have a lot of the same, we like a lot of the same things. I think perhaps a lot of the other people who were asked to interview Jerry fled because they were intimidated by the fact that, among other things, they were expected to be in conversation with a writer who, whose first full-length crime novel, his second novel, is due to be published any day now, who has, this very year, published two outstanding, rigorous translations of brilliantly interesting memoirs, both from the Marathi, and who was recently awarded one of the literary world's top prizes, which is the Wyndham Campbell Yale Prize, which recognized him for his outstanding achievement in fiction. Have you slept at all this year, Jerry?
You know, when I was growing up, there was this man.
Answer the question.
Oh, sorry. I was trying to actually, but. But, you know, one of my students once said, whatever question you ask, Jerry, now, it has to start with the Bible. And it ends in the present day. So keep the question. Anyway, so when I was growing up, there was this mathematics teacher who came into class in the 12th standard, and he was trying to get us aware of how little time we had to prepare for this exam. So he started by saying, how many hours in the day? So we said 24, because that we were sure of. How many hours you are sleeping? So everyone thought nice to say 8 hours of sleep, because we were told that was necessary. 8 hours. One third of your life is gone. How many hours in the bathroom? 1 hour. How many hours commuting? 1 hour. And in that way, he proved that we had very little time left to study for the exam. But my brain actually got stopped on that one third of your life will be spent sleeping. And like a totally dysfunctional young man, I assumed that this is wasted time. And the only way to deal with this would be to make sure that I cut down my sleep systematically over the next 1 year by reducing it 10 minutes every week. So that finally I came down to the point at which I was just sleeping 4 hours a day, and I thought I was sleeping concentratedly and I was sleeping with intensity, and the rest of the 20 hours I could engage with the world. And by the time I got to like the age of 40, I was completely ill. I was kind of like falling over myself, tired most of the time. I was being like a complete maniac, and then I started writing it, and now I sleep 8 hours. I'm sorry, all answers take a little time and a little exposition. That's the problem with fiction writing.
I'm very happy to hear though that you've resumed a kind of healthy sleeping schedule. Tell us a little bit about the Wyndham Campbell Prize and the circumstances in which you received it and what it was like to to be part of this quite giant honor.
Yeah, it's very big. You know, I was in Jaipur at the literary festival, and I went to
this year,
meaning at the beginning of the year, and I popped into I went to the writer's ball. Meaning, you know, there is nothing more, a ball should be places where like women in big gowns sweep across the room.
I guess you didn't see me.
Oh yeah, if I had seen you, then I would have swept you across the room somewhere. But it was a huge space, and it was like on the fringes of Jaipur, where modernity was beginning to crumble because there was a baked fish being served. A big baked fish. Like, oh, this like jaws had been caught and steamed. And the guy was trying to cut bits off it and it was just flaking, so he just dropped the knife and started taking chunks with his hand and slapping them on plates. So I thought, okay, this writer's ball is not working. I ate my food, which was the idea, and I popped out into the parking lot and looked for somebody to get back. And there was this slim, nice young man standing there, and I said, let's travel together. And I said, what are you, who are you? And he said, I'm Michael Kelleher and I'm a poet. And I said, well, I've read some of your work. And this may have actually made the difference, I think. Because when you say to a poet, I've read some of your work, they don't even ask what work. Happily accept it. You tell a novelist this, I've read some of your work, and they say, which novel?
Yeah.
You know, because they know they have readers. Poets don't have readers, so they're willing to. If you say you read their work, that's enough also. Just shut up, don't ask, because you know, it'll turn out to be like, you know, William Wordsworth's poem that they ascribe to you. Anyway, so we're sitting and chatting, and he was telling me about this Wyndham Campbell Prize, and I said, I don't know. I said, that's really lovely. It's a lovely idea for a prize. Because this is the story, right? Sandy Wyndham and Campbell are gay lovers. They meet when they're young, and one dies, leaves his shares to the other guy. And his advisors tell him, you've got this big bunch of shares in one company, don't be silly, now sell them, split it all up, and buy other companies. And Wyndham says, nothing doing. These are a gift of love. And I will keep them as they are. I will not touch them. And they say, idiot. But then this company is bought by another bigger company, and Wyndham is richer. But Wyndham is not spending his money. He's quietly living on a rent-controlled duplex apartment overlooking Central Park in New York, for which he pays like $800 or something. He wears old clothes, he only writes, he totters about bookshops, buys poetry and comes home. And this company is bought again, and he gets richer. And like, towards the end of his life, he's sitting on $1 billion of love, really of love, because he kept the faith with his love. Oh. So then he decides that, you know, he realizes that the way that writers often cannot write because they're so busy earning a living. So he wants to give this prize to people so that they will be allowed to write. Oh. So he goes to Yale. And he tells Yale, I have this money to offer, and you know. And Yale says, we have too many prizes already. And who will run it? We don't want your $1 billion. You must remember that Yale has more money than sub-Saharan Africa, all of it put together. And they're taking more and more from young people all over the place and leaving them in debt. But it doesn't matter. That's the capitalist system. Finally, they are persuaded, the Beinecke Library is persuaded, which is a beautiful library. It's one column of books set inside a monolith of grey marble. They agree to post this prize, and every one of us gets $150,000 in cash. And the American government takes 33 1/3%, straight off. Yeah. And you get a check, and you think, me? Okay, but really, me? Right up to the time I got the check, I thought, at some point someone's going to come and say, fool ya! It's actually the S-type, Paul, who's getting it. This was a joke, and this is candid camera, and I'll start crying, babies. Or whatever. I just think, because there's nothing after, like, it's such a kind prize at some fundamental level. Because other prizes turn you into gladiators. Like, there are 4 or 5 people on the shortlist. And they're the gay, your book. I mean, what are they thinking? My book, yeah, naturally they selected my book. But his book, you write so. You turn into gladiators for this prize. Here there's nothing. You are only told when you win it. There's no shortlist, no long list, everything is in secret. Until the time that you are told, please come to America on a business class ticket. Please bring a plus one on a business class ticket. Please come and stay in Yale. And we will host you. I want to kiss them. I for the 6 months that we were preparing to go, my sister and I, we just kept filling a bag full of gifts to give to Yale. Anybody we met, we gave a gift because we're just so happy to be there. It's like silk stole, terilly scarf, terilly wooden ornament, terilly this. It's just had to be gifts all over the place. It's like, I don't know how to deal with this. Like, you just gave me $105,000. Why? Sorry, is that like too much of an answer?
It certainly says something that's interesting to me, which is I think that your literary career, among other things, has been very masterful at deflection. Nice. I see you're still doing it with the facial expression. And it says something interesting to me that the Winner Campbell Prize recognized you for the sole full-length work of fiction that you produced, which was M and the Big Room, a novel that's very close to my heart, which I recommend to everybody who hasn't read it yet. There must be very few of you who haven't. Please do. It's extraordinary. It's also not only the single most autobiographical thing that I think Jerry has written, but also one of the most intimate and emotionally honest novels I've ever read.
I now get it what she's saying. So elegantly she put it there. He is deflecting, which means he's not being emotionally honest and sincere here, but he was emotionally honest and sincere.
I'm not at all suggesting that he was being insincere.
No. Okay, see, so I completely get it. I mean, you're right. It was that prize was about a book. I should have talked about the book rather than emotional response. You're totally correct. So let me talk about
it. But it's also very exciting to hear about you becoming rich and all of that.
No. Let's get one thing clear about rich. Rich is when you earn $105,000 in a quarter and you think, how can I maximize it in the next quarter? Yeah. Lucky is when you get one prize. That's the difference. So I'm lucky. I got the prize. And I always say, you know, with all prizes, there is a measure of talent. This is true. I feel that I wrote a good book. Luck by chance, I wrote M in the Big Book. When I read it, sometimes I think, oh, Jerry, you did a good job there. This seems a bit distant now. But I did it. I did it. I own it. I own that talent. I own that luck. I own that everything. I'm not denying that. I'm saying, when you know how prizes are given, you also know there's a fair element of chance and lottery there. You know, you're hung up and
someone has to nominate you.
Then someone has to read you.
Yes, know? Exactly.
Yeah. And M and the Big Room story is a story of like complete, like when it went into David Godwin's hands as the agent, he said, it's not the book I expected you to write because you're generally very funny, but I'll take it. And now that should have warned me that he didn't trust the book. At some fundamental level, he was saying, chal, main tere liye karta, you know, it's like that. I'll do it for you. And David Godwin did not reply for 6 months, so I wrote him and I said, not to be pushy, but do you think you could tell me anything's happening? I got back a one-word answer in the header of the email. No. Or no, nothing. So, few weeks later, after I recovered from this dhakka, you take time to like, because the first email I wrote was, you so then I wrote another email saying, you know, could you tell me just a little more about who you offered it to? And offered it to all the majors, they all turned you down, but don't worry, we'll try the minors now. Thank you, boss. 6 weeks later, I write and I say, any luck with the minors? Another line. Nothing. So, okay, I say to myself, this book has a fate and a career about Indian India. This is meant to be an Indian book. And, you know, that's all right. That's nothing, I mean, this is who the book is. And then I went to meet for the interview Pankaj Mishra. And at the end of the interview, before I left the house, I was thinking, put the book in the bag, don't put the book back. Finally, I put the book in the bag. And I said to myself on the way, you do the interview and at the end, see. Interview went very well, we talked and it was just gorgeous dealing with a fine mind like that. And then at the end, I took out the book and I said, Pankaj, I've written a novel, and his face froze. You know, he put on that big author look, which is, Yeah. And then he said what everyone says, which is he accepted it. I said, oh, lovely, and I don't know when I'll have time to read this. I said, no. And I left the room and I thought, never again, book. I'm sorry, I will not do that to you again. I promise. And I went home and I just said, forget about it. Doesn't matter. Let it go. Then a couple of weeks later, I get an email which says, I'm in Tokyo airport. It's a blizzard that has cancelled my flight and I have nothing to read and the bookshop has only Japanese books, so I might read your book. So I hit reply. My first word is unprintable. It ends in cho.
I feel like that was the unprintable part.
So I delete that email because I've been told by a very, very sensible female friend, when you're angry, write the email but don't send it. Keep it as a draft and send it the next day. So I leave it, and 1 hour later he says, he writes another email saying, I'm halfway through your book, but I want to recommend it for the Statesman Books of the Year Award, Books of the Year list. Who is your publisher in England? And I write back and say, nobody. So he writes back immediately saying, who's your agent? I say, David Godwin. He says, Natural Air. Though Arundhati Roy was David Godwin was Arundhati Roy's agent back in the day. And then he says, can I suggest it to Mary? Mary Mount of Penguin, UK, his wife? It is just joy. Okay, child, of course, yeah, go ahead, come on, go. I sent it to her. I was, oh, lovely, so I was trying to be all cool and collected, and all that would be nice. But will it do? Anyway, so, but there's a little downside to the story, which I must warn you about. So Marymount writes to me and says, I loved it, but you know, it has to go through the process. And I will ask one of my editors to read it. But Tonya, your chief editor, says, I love this book, you should read it. And it's like unlikely that you're going to say, no, I hate it. Unless you want to leave the company or something. So this editor also likes it, and we're signing up, and she says, can we do America as well? So I said, of course. Because at this point, I'm desperate. I thought there was going to be no international future. So guess what my signing amount for America was? No? $15.
No.
$15.
What?
Duniya mein humai hai to China hi padega. Jeevan hai idhar se kar to China hi padega. So I took $15 and I took America and I took England and I got Indian captain. So everything evens out in the end. I have no issues with that.
Congratulations. Yes. Was there ever a moment in your now quite long literary career, because you started out as a prodigy, that you thought, oh yeah, I'm a writer?
It's prodigy. My first book was at 30.
I was thinking of this as...
But she obviously sees me as very dumb. So like my 30, okay, managed, he's a prodigy.
I was like, some of us are late bloomers. But before you published a book,
yeah,
you were a journalist.
Yeah.
You'd been writing for a while.
Yeah.
Did it really take the publication of your first book for you to think, oh, I'm a writer? There are some lucky people who at like 10 have like looked at a book on their father's bookshelf and thought, oh, I'm going to be on that bookshelf one day.
It would be, okay, there's one Jerry Fitto that comes and sits on the stage and does this stuff, and there's one Jerry Fitto who's at home and who's like filled with insecurity, like,
yes,
at some very fundamental level, insecure about everything, and therefore lots of braggadocio, bluster, change of costume, everything will be part of just some really sad attempt at facade building across those insecurities.
The literary device is deflection.
Yeah, deflection, okay. I don't, like, when someone says you're Jerry Pinto the writer, at this point in time, even today, I think, I write, but I don't know if I merit this term, the writer. For me, that's a very big term, and it's a very small self that I take there to inhabit that term. And I know, you can say, like, 25 books, I've just been this false modesty. It's not. You know, I long to be a CA. I long to be a plumber or a mason. When the plumber flushes the toilet and it all goes away, his job is done. He can go home and have a cup of tea and think, I'm a good plumber, I am. When the mason hangs the plumb line and it hangs straight and the wall is fixed, you know you've done a good job, you go home, relax. The writer must deal with the constant, constant fear that his best work is behind him. That it's not going to come back. That the wellspring may run dry at any moment. That the words may abandon him. That these are not words coming out of the depths of truth. That these are words coming out of a false self. It's nightmarish, but I would not want to live any other way. Okay, so I am always on, and which is why I'm the easiest, I'm the pushover. I can be made to do 4 consecutive events in the morning because I'm just so glad to be at a writer's festival. You're like, I wish it were effort. And even like the starting of my writing career would not have started had it not been for my friend Rashmi Balkiwala, who used to say, you can write, you should write, you can write. And then one day she said to me, I'm not going to talk to you about writing again. I won't talk to you. I'll talk to you because you're my friend, but I won't ask you to write because you've not been writing though I've asked you to write. I was really frightened by that. I said, there's one person who trusts me to write. So I went home, and on the bus, I started writing my first piece of funny journalism, like middles and stuff like that. Over the next 7 days, I wrote 14 pieces. It was like something unstopped inside me, and the words pouring out, everything. I found a pimple on my face, tale of a thousand pimples. I met somebody. It just came out as if unstoppable.
How old were you?
I know exactly how old, 21, my father had died. So I stepped up to the plate, you know, so yes. All kinds of things happening in my life. And suddenly writing was also happening. And I remember every night and every day praying for a writing career. Like I would say, I have 10 bucks, I can smoke three cigarettes, or I can give this to a beggar. I will give this to a beggar, but please note this goes towards my writing career. Odd bargains that I would make with the fates, with God, with everybody, for my writing career, for my writing career. I'll teach one extra hour for my writing career. I look back and think, all you had to do was write, idiot. You didn't have to do this. But it was so, so much inside my head that it was a very, very far grail, you know. And this was because I went to college. Seems like an easy poem even for me. And she started by saying, everyone here must have read Beware of Pitel by Stefan Zweig. No one has read.
And alas.
But you're making that note. Quietly you're making that note. Beware. It's like beware, you say. I thought you said beware. What is beware of Pitel by Stefan Zweig? Okay. And then I went out and tried to get Beware of Pitel. And tried to Beware of Pitel and read it. So it's like, I had the absolute good luck to be surrounded by people who were so far superior to me that two things happened. One is that I was sure that I was not going to be a writer because I had not read Beware of Pitel or 6 versions of Homer like these two young men had. And they were younger than me also, damn it. It was like no excuses. And the second thing that happened was actually a good thing, which is you constantly spent your time trying to improve yourself. Like you're constantly saying, oh, what are you reading? Oh, make a note. I'll also read it quickly. You know, it's kind of like that. I think in some ways also, now I look back at it and I think I was the victim of a certain, not a key victim, but what was happening was that there was a certain elitism inside me also. That you had to be a certain kind of person to be a writer. You know, you had to have certain intellectual abilities. And I think right now, for me now, I think you must simply want to write. And you must want so badly to write that you will do what it takes to become a writer. And to do what it takes to become a writer means to listen carefully. Reading is one listening, one careful and attentive listening to the other. But listening is also important. Listening to the person next to you, listening to the person on the bus, listening for rhythms of conversation, listening for rhythms of poetry, listening for the hidden rhythms of language. All these also are important. And this listeningness is the secret of writing. And then do your homework, read the books, spend your time, rewrite. Rewriting is also important, all that. But it is never about whether you've read Homer or not. Never. It is never about that. It is about how much you can, you let your tentacles, and we are all actually like, this is the physical body, but the emotional body is just about tentacles in the sea, sweeping the sea, and how much we will let them touch other people, connect with those other people, be hurt, be broken by those other people, but then come back again for more connection. I think that's kind of like what I'd say.
It just feels like there were a bunch of you running around in Bombay being crazy talented. And you know, just perhaps feeding off of each other. Was that the truth?
Absolutely true. You know, we started the poetry circle. The poetry circle was not started by me, it was started by a bunch of other poets.
Sorry, poets, to also to interject, this wasn't all that long ago, you know, but I feel like, I mean, I'd love to hear more about this simply because all of this happened just before it could be documented for posterity by your tweets and your Facebook posts.
Yeah, you know, it was a lovely, strange, potent moment that Nissim Ezekiel was sitting in the theosophy. You could go, knock on the door, and Nissim's toes would be cocked up. He would bring them down and say, who is it, and talk to you. You could bring him your poems. Adil Chasawala was having a drink, persistent number of drinks all over the city. And he would be scathing sometimes, but he would also have time for you. Geev Patel was in the city. I remember one day walking down the road and Geev Patel and A.K. Ramanujan were walking up the road and going to see Nissim Ezekiel, and I said, I'm going to work, and I think, now why didn't you just follow them into that room and sit there and listen? What gyan! Three poets, one translator from God. You know, you had work to do. Chut, dumb fuck. You should have just banned. That was your work. To go and sit there and listen. Why didn't you edit the truth? Huh? Dick. Yeah. Okay, sorry.
Two different things.
I'm saying, okay. Penis. Genitalia. Why didn't you go? And then I see. So, in some ways, I was treated with cruel kindness by all of them. The cruelty was in reading your poems and saying, Nissim's favorite comment was, which meant, what is this, a poem or? But he wouldn't say that, he'd just say, If the poem worked, he'd say there's a comma missing on the second line. That was what he'd say. Okay. Adil was very different. Adil would be, yes, of course, poetry. To begin with poetry. Yes. Meaning, Adil, everything you're guessing, because there's one layer behind which there's another layer, and there's a self-editing process which he's not saying. So you have to. So all you can do is jump the gun and say, "Yeah, I know it's very bad." Oh God, says Adil, "It's not very bad. Of course, it's not very bad." And there's Arundhati, who starts by saying,
"Subramanian,
the poet." Such richness, such joy and delight in sharing. Evenings spent in the poetry circle just attending to form, looking at the surface of poems, looking at words, looking carefully at sound and rhythm and meaning. It was just, I mean, I was so lucky. I think we all got really lucky to have found each other in this kind of moment of half development. You know, you're half yourself, and you're seeking that other half from the stains and hybridities and interpolations of other people. I think it was a great time, absolutely great time. Though when you're doing it, you're not aware of it. You're thinking, yeah, that's stupid, I don't get my quote.
You're thinking that the glories of the past will never come to you.
Yeah.
You know, I have a bunch more questions I want to ask Jerry. We have a little bit of time left though. I'm selfishly and grudgingly going to ask if any of you have questions. And if you don't, I'm just going to continue until the end of the session.
Yes, yes, good. Fine. I am just curious to know
from you, what is the future of writers in this world? I mean, I have a few writer friends, and of course I was sitting with you, and they talk about the meager earnings and how they have to share that with their agents. And add to that the ruse of the publishing industry. you keep hearing and you keep reading about how they are not doing so well, and the word, you know, sunset industry. So, and also all the changes happening, you know, in the digital world, everybody seeking quick answers, everything going audiovisual. So what would writers like you, and also maybe budding writers here, do? Should they enter this industry? Is your tribe diminishing? And if not, then how should you, or should you at all, change yourself to adapt to the new world? So just look into the future.
Quick answer, I have no crystal ball. I wish I did, then I would adapt, or not adapt as the case may be. But I'll say one thing, the story will not die. If the moment fiction will die is when you don't want to gossip about your friends. Because gossip is the first and easiest and cheapest form of fiction. Telling stories and listening to those stories. That's gossip, right? And gossip, at its highest level, is fiction. Okay? So the story is in no danger, because when life was brutish, nasty, short, cheap, we stopped to paint on walls as Neanderthal man. We need to represent ourselves. We will represent ourselves. The form will change. Forms will change. Stories will remain. And as long as you're willing to tell stories, you're fine. Now, as for the recipe, you know, people write me and say, well, you all already tell their books on Twitter. Actually, I have no issues. I write the story. Now, if you want to change it into other shapes and forms, that's your decision. No one's ever asked me to write a film. But someone once asked me to write a short story for a film and was willing to give me 8 lakhs for a 10-page short story. I thought, if I do this, I can live for 2 years. I didn't do it for other reasons. But that's the kind of money that's also available. So all this about, like, I mean, you know, these terrible fears that, oh, this won't happen, that won't happen. You scratch a reader and underneath is a writer. Everyone who's a passionate reader wants to have their name on the spine of a book. And the spine of the book is the fetish object right now. The book is the fetish object. The fetish may move and shift. That's not the point. The story will remain. The impulse to tell the story will remain. And that's fine. And as long as that's fine, it will find a form. And people who want to tell those stories will find the forms of them within which to tell them, and will change to tell those stories. Don't mind.
Sorry, I'm going to take the moderator's privilege to wrest this back from the audience. Because you mentioned film, and I don't feel like I can let you go without talking about you know, your engagement with film, the fact that you've written several books about Hindi cinema, which you love, but which you don't write about anymore.
Well, you know, actually the wonderful, strange thing that happened over the course of a weekend is I suddenly decided I wanted to write an encyclopedia of film. Okay, now, so let's not make this small. So what I will do is I've set myself like about 40 subjects, and I will write a 5,000-word essay on each of those subjects, and I will cover much of Hindi film with that, which is like a tiny kind of bizarre kind of thing, but it's keeping me so amused most free time that, you know, that, see, I have the feeling that there is, when I started writing about films, there were no Supriya Nairs. There were no people, there was no good writing on cinema that actually didn't talk about, you know, someone's bra size and someone who was sleeping with whom, or whether films were doing well or not. Now there are lots of people who are doing it. I don't feel under pressure anymore, because I read other people say, ah, that's what I thought. You know, I'm like, ah, he's also saying it. Oh, that guy's also writing so well, Jai Arjun Singh, lots of people like that. You know, actually doing the kind of, this kind of work, and I feel, ah, kar beta. You know, like, you all take that forward. I'm doing other things. So it's sometimes just nice when there are lots of voices in the room, because you don't always agree with that voice, but it's a voice that has the same basic political and social agenda as you have. Basic. The finer points will be different.
So it's kind of a utilitarian thing, film writing.
So film writing has been a kind of like utilitarian thing.
No, it was always like a like Helen, I could not have written unless it was out of a deep distilled passion for Mungara. Mungara, main gudki Delhi.
No, you're singing it very badly. Please don't.
And you know, this is the problem with this elitism. You have to do it. At some point you can do things badly, you can fail, it's all right. I mean, you know, when you look at Helen dancing Mungara, Mungara, main gudki Delhi, you want to ask questions about pleasure. A pastime up. She's saying time after the back. You want to ask questions about pleasure. You want to ask questions about a white woman in a brown man's world. You want to talk about cinema. And that, so for me, it wasn't utilitarian. It was a passionate engagement with material. But when I see other passionate engagements entering the room, I feel welcoming. I feel like, aja baitho. Let's talk about it through your book. So I'm listening to them through their books. Thank you all very much. I'm really sorry if I babbled too much and I didn't allow you to finish your questions.
No.
Thank you.
You didn't, but thank you very much. This is what we came here for, to hear you speak rather than. Thank you all for listening.